back, flying to work again today. So let's get some fuel in Bess, and maybe this time we'll think of something interesting to talk about on the way. Bess here is a light sport, is considered a legacy light sport aircraft, so maybe we'll talk about that.
Alright, controls, that one's up, that one's down, that one's up, that one's down, elevator up, down, rudder left, right, instruments, set altimeter to field altitude, oil pressure looks good, oil temperature's off the peg, gas, fuel's on, car seat's off, primer is locked, airplane stuff, trim is set. Seat belts are both lashed so they don't get in the controls. Doors off. We'll give the engine just one more minute to warm up. Briefing. When my engine fails today, it'll be a straight ahead or a slight left into the open fields to avoid power lines. If I'm lucky and the engine doesn't fail today, then we'll continue on to work.
Holding traffic, champ November 1476 Echo, taking off runway 17, holding.
Tails up. There's 40. He's ready to fly. Accelerate to 50. Climb out. Cleared the trees, accelerate to 60. Flight left to stay above the power lines. We're above the glide path to the power lines. We go fly over the house real quick. All right, let's head to work. Alright, we can start leveling off. We're at 1,000 feet AGL. And throttle back to about 2,100 RPM, 2,150. Somewhere in there is a good cruise setting. So as I was saying before pre-flight, Bess is considered a legacy light sport aircraft, so I guess what does that mean? So the FAA, there's two parts. There's the pilot certification, and then there's the aircraft certification. And both were released, I believe, in 2004 as an FAA rulemaking. And the intent was to lower the barrier of entry, both cost and training, into aviation in an attempt to get more people involved. Probably be argued whether it was successful in that intent, but for some people I think it is a good option. So compared to a private pilot certificate, you need half the hours before taking a check ride. A private pilot certificate requires 40 hours of flight time. And a sport pilot requires 20 hours of flight time. Now, whether you actually get it done in 20 is maybe up for debate. I think it probably takes closer to 25 on average, but the reality is the training costs about half of what private pilot training would cost. So that's a big barrier of entry reduced. The second big barrier of entry, particularly for older folks or those with health issues, is the lack of a need for an FAA medical certificate to get your private pilot certificate. An active state driver's license is all you need for medical proof or your sport pilot certificate. Now that said, if you've ever failed an FAA medical certificate of the third class, you must pass that third class medical certificate before you can exercise sport pilot privileges. If you've never taken it, then your driver's license is fine. If you've taken the medical and you failed, your driver's license is no longer acceptable. So, that means if you are exercising private pilot privileges and you're aging, and you're concerned that maybe you're not going to pass medical next time around, have a talk with your medical examiner that's not an official medical. Do not take that medical until you've had a discussion with your examiner to see if you are likely to pass or likely to fail. If you're likely to fail, do not take the medical. Let your medical expire, and you can exercise sport pilot privileges. Now, with those lower barriers to entry, there is some reduced capability, I guess. You're only allowed to fly in daylight hours. You can only fly less than 10,000 feet or 2,000 foot above ground level, whichever is higher. You're restricted from entering Bravo, Charlie, or Delta airspace unless you have an endorsement from a CFI to enter those airspaces. That's not really a big deal to get. And you're restricted to flying light sport category aircraft. So a light sport category aircraft is limited to 1,320 pounds. It's limited to 120 knots, freight level flight, and they only have capability for two passengers, a pilot and one passenger. Light sport aircraft are split into a couple of categories, as far as at least the airplanes are. There's also weight shift trikes and powered parachutes, etc., that fall under light sport, but we won't get into those today. You have the light sport aircraft certified under the ASTM standards, which is what was developed in 2004. And those are the newer aircraft, such as the Flight Design, CTLS, the Vans RV-12, the certified version, and E-Vector, Sportstar, a lot of these European light sport aircraft manufacturers. There's also what's considered the legacy light sport aircraft, which is something like Bess, the Champier. And these are standard certificated airplanes that happen to meet the requirements of a light sport aircraft. Bess weighs 1,220 pounds gross, so she's 100 pounds under the limit. She's never going to hit 120 knots in straight level, and she's got two passengers with fixed gear and all the other minor requirements that I did not get into. So there's a lot of airplanes that fall into that legacy light sport category. Champs, J3 Cubs, I should say not all Champs, 7AC Champs do, and some of the other Champs do, but some Champs get too heavy. Some Aircoops or Aircoops, some Luscombs, most Taylorcraft B series, and others. These are published. You can go take a look. So I am a private pilot. I do keep a medical, and I do fly some other airplanes from time to time. But most of what I fly is at best, and I can get by just fine in with a light sport pilot's license. So, is a light sport pilot's license for you? Well, that's kind of a tough question to answer, and I think the most important thing is, what's your mission? If your mission is to take your family of four on trips several times a year in an airplane, then life support aircraft are not for you. You can only carry two people, and it's just not going to work. If your mission is to go have some fun and fly kind of like I do, fly best, go see the sights, go see what's going around you, and you don't necessarily care about going super fast, or if you're, say, a retired couple or single and you want to do some traveling in VFR conditions, sure. Some of these newer light sport aircraft that'll cruise at 120 knots, that's every bit as fast as a Cessna 172, and I think you'll do just fine in a light sport aircraft. I think the bigger barrier to light sport aircraft is what you have available to you. Here in the Kansas City area, there's one light sport aircraft that I'm aware of that's available to rent. So, you need to consider that when you're getting your lesson. If there's anything available for you to rent after you get your certificate. So if you plan to buy an airplane like a Legacy Light Sport, you know, you can get into something like a Champ or a Chief or a Taylorcraft for between $20,000 and $30,000. So that could be a good option to get buy yourself an airplane, or go in partners with an airplane, or join a club that has something that's considered light sport. Then that makes sense. Just make sure you have access to a light sport aircraft, whether that's renting or some sort of purchase or shared purchase agreement. If you don't have access, there's no point in getting the light sport certificate. So consider the mission, whether those restrictions actually matter to you. In most cases, I think they don't for a lot of fun flying. And finally, consider the availability of aircraft to you, whether you want to purchase an airplane, or if you're in a larger metropolitan area that might have plenty of light sport aircraft, then great. You can always upgrade a light sport pilot's license to a private pilot's license. There is certainly some rework there. You take two check rides, you take two written, so you're going to end up spending a little bit more money if you do your sport pilot first and then move on to private. But you can always upgrade later if you decide. I think for a lot of people, light sport makes a lot of sense. As long as your mission is to go have some fun and you have access to an airplane. So when it's all said and done, and I know there's some schools that train in Taylorcrafts and Cubs, and a lot of times those airplanes are renting for less than $100 an hour, with all in with an instructor, another maybe $50 an hour. So $150 an hour times 20 hours, you're talking, you know, $3,000 in flight time, plus another couple hundred dollars for your written test, couple hundred dollars for your ground school, another $500 to $700 for your check ride. You could be into a sport pilot's license for roughly $4,000, which is pretty close to half of what it's going to take you to get a private pilot's license. Johnson County Executive Tower. Chamber number 1476 echoes 4.5 northwest inbound with Kilo.
Chamber 1476 echo, exact enter right base from runway 18.
Right base runway 18 for 1476 echo.
Hey, Executive Tower, Citation 10 Papa Fox, we're ready for departure runway 18.
Citation 10 Papa Fox, exact on runway 18, left down when departure's approved, clear for takeoff. The Cessna just departed, he'll be making left traffic, so turn outside him.
All right, sure, we see him, and we're going to make a left turn outside, and we're cleared for takeoff.
The Yankee runway 18, clear for touch and go. If you could keep your pattern in close, I got traffic inbound from the northwest to follow you.
18, clear touch and go, keep it close, 5 Yankee.
Champ 176 Echo, number two, following a Cessna on the left downwind approaching left base. Let me know when you see the Cessna.
Yeah, I'm looking for the Cessna, 1476 Echo.
Champ 76 Echo, you can turn eastbound into the right base. That Cessna's on short final. Number two, runway 18, clear to land.
Right base, 1476 Echo, clear to land.
Sir, Romeo Bravo, extend your downwind. I'll call your base for number three.
Staying down, then. Zero, Willie Row.
Helicopter 65 Victor Fox, exact.
Helicopter 65 Victor Fox is here at Red Rock. I got a departure directed to the northeast.
65 Victor Fox, Roger. From the northeast ramp, you can depart southbound, and I'll call your left turn.
Depart southbound, and you'll call my left turn. 65 Victor Fox.
Citation Zero Papa Fox, traffic about 2 or 1.5 miles southeast is a Cirrus at 3,500 climbing.
Okay, we've got him inside. Is he inbound to you?
No, he's departing. He departed New Century. He's climbing.
Okay, thanks.
65 Victor Fox, you can start that left turn northeastbound.
Let's start my left turn to the northeast, 65 Victor Fox.
Zero, Mike Bravo, you're following a champ just off your left side on final. Do you have him in sight?
I'm looking for a tower. Actually, I do have him in sight. Romeo Bravo.
Zero, Mike Bravo, Roger. You can turn your base your discretion. Follow the champ, number two, runway 18, clear for touch and go.
Runway 18, clear for touch and go. Romeo Bravo.
Champ 76 Echo, where would you like to park?
Eastbound.
76 Echo, turn left, taxi via Bravo Delta, the eastbound.